Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Apologies are offered to everybody who's locked outside. That's because the Treasurer arranged it for people attending the AGM to get in free. So if you'd come along earlier, you would have got in for nothing. We've had a wee bit of technical problems, mainly with Mr. Matheson's hearing aids. Are you hearing me?
Half. I'm only hearing half of what you're saying.
Yeah.
And I hope I'll get the right half.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Ready to go?
On you go.
Yeah. When we were preparing for this talk, we were asked by our committee members, what are we going to call the talk? So we suggested more Stornoway shops. And then the secretary told us he used that last year. So it's now even more Stornoway shops. Now, we're going to move up Church Street, Sandy.
Are we?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mitchell's buses could do it, so we can do it as well.
Can I move this, Clendy? I've moved that. Okay. Church Street.
Is it okay for the Americans if we move it? We've had complaints about America for not having close-ups of you, Sandy.
Yes.
Jimmy McClellan wanted a close-up of you.
On that.
Not quite. You've a face for that.
You know, if I was blind as distinct from deaf, he would be up for some kind of unpolitical conduct. However, am I going to start? Well, I am going to start.
Number three or what? Are you going to start at 3 Church Street or?
Am I going to what?
Which side are you starting on?
This side here. Side with number one.
Okay.
I'm only going on the... I should explain, folks, that I'm having a bad night tonight with the hearing aids. I hadn't paid my meter before I left the house, so I wasn't able to charge them. Anyway, we're going to deal tonight, I think, with time will only permit us to deal with two streets, Church Street and Francis Street. And you'll know, those of you have heard from us before, that we just move along the street and we hope that you will know what's on the present streets, because we will try to relate the present addresses to their history. And you won't be surprised if we tend to deal with the shops on both these streets as we knew them. Also, Malcolm very kindly suggested last week we could go back in our history of the streets as far as the First World War. So I had to tell Malcolm that I wasn't around then, but I picked it up since the Second World War. So I hope that most of you will be able to follow the geography of our walk. And just before we go into the various addresses and places on Church Street, just want to remind you that Church Street was a name given to that street in the middle of the 19th century, certainly on the 1849 map of Stornoway. There are only half a dozen streets in the town, and one of them is actually Church Street. But if you go back a bit earlier to an earlier chart, John Wood, map 1821 of Stornoway, you'll see that at the top of Church Street, or very close to the top of Church Street, where the junction is with Louis Street, there is, of course, the church. That is the current old parish church, St. Columba's. And it did exist then because it was built in 1794. It wasn't the first church in Stornoway. The first church that we know of in the town of Stornoway was St. Lennon's on North Beach. And when I say it's where the sailor's home was, some of you may wonder where that was. Well, it's now part of the council campus, and it is between the Royal Bank of Scotland and the T.B. Macaulay's, if you want to put it like that. But there I go again, using names that not everybody is familiar with. Anyway, the very first church in Stornoway came with the Fife Adventurers when King James the First and Sixth sent the famous Fife Adventurers to colonise the place in 1595 or thereabouts. And they brought with them a minister, not just for their own use, but the minister had the particular remit of Christianizing the inhabitants. And I think you can see how successful he was. Because a few years after Mr. Drury came, the Fife Adventurers had to clear off because they were being massacred left, right and centre. But anyway, that was the first church. In due course, that church fell into ruin, and in 1794, St. Columbus was built at the top of the Brae, and hence the name Church Street. And as you know, Church Street goes from Cromwell Street all the way up to the junction with Matheson Road. And now, Malcolm, we'll get down to your own work. So thank you for helping me. And we're doing it by numbers. And we're going to start off with number 1 Church Street, which is on the right-hand side as you go up the Brae, where the jewellery shop is now, on Cromwell Street.
Yeah, on the corner.
On the corner. I understand that that whole block from the corner right up to Kennan Street was obviously at one time just one one garden with the house that we know on the front of the house. But that's not on the front of the few. That's not what we're going to be talking about. It's just round the corner. And again, you'll know that as you go up Church Street, there's a little cool on your right-hand side. There's a door that goes into, is it Gladstone House?
Cobden House was on the front,
Gladstone House was on the right-hand side. So we're going to go up the Brae, which at one time was actually called Syme's Brae. Isn't that right, Malcolm?
We're going to meet Mr. Syme later on.
Yes, but we'll mention him later on, but nonetheless, it was Syme's Brae, I think, that went up there. So the first shop became in 1935 or 36, it became part of the Lipton's property.
Yes.
And again, you could go in a side door into what was to us Lipton's shop, now the jewellery shop. And we have here at number 1, that was slightly downhill, and they owned 1 and 3 Lipton's, and over the period of time these properties have changed. Malcolm, yes. Can you bring us up to date?
Number 3 is Hebridean Books, and Hebridean Jewellery were in that area. It was a side, but they have a little window.
Uh-huh.
But you can't go in the door. I think it's like a emergency exit.
Yes.
Like directly across the road was another entrance into Mr. McCormack's, the hairdresser.
Yes.
But you can't, it's been blocked off as well.
As we go up on the right-hand side of that Brae, again, I'm going to relate it to my own time. You'll remember that there was the fish shop, Bain's Fish Shop, and beside that, there was the baby shop.
That was number 7, yes.
Is that number 7?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm jumping ahead very quickly, Malcolm, and I'm just picking up the streets.
Yeah.
And when I say it was a baby shop, you'll realise that I'm talking about it's a shop not for babies, but for baby clothes. Anyway, the ladies in that was John Murdo Baines, a Stornoway gentleman of the famous Bain family. And John Murdo Bain had his fish shop there, and beside that, his wife and his daughters ran the baby shop.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
And now, if we, who's in there now?
Number seven. Did I take a note of that?
Come on, you people, tell me who's.
Woolshop, yes.
There you are.
Well, wool for you.
It's one of the
wool for you. That's
one of the interesting things about my stage in life is now I can usually tell you what happened 100 years ago, but what's what today is just gone. I'm sure you're all like that. Yes, good to know. So there was the fish shop, mm-hmm. And then
John McKeever took it over.
John McKeever took it over. And
that'd be about the early 60s.
It became a. Did it become John Mordebain died. The pin shop after that. No,
oh,
that
no,
was
the pin
died.
Shop's further up.
Uh-huh. So after that, we came the shop above that at number where, Malcolm?
Well, above number seven was number nine, which was briefly.
Oh, yes, Mr. William Arif, turf accountant. I certainly remember that gentleman. And of course, you'll all know that a turf accountant has got to do with horse racing, nothing to do with gardening. And he created quite a stir by being the first bookies shop in Stornoway. And I remember certainly when I was a youngster of naturally great opposition to the bookies shop.
You thought it was a bookshop that was setting up.
Yes, I thought it was a bookshop, but I was trying to stop it, Malcolm, yes. So that was William Arif.
Do you remember as tannoy was going, especially on a Saturday, you'd be hearing 3-1 the fields, you know, things like that.
Yes. Mm. I was never, needless to say, I was never in it. I don't know. Sure, none of you would admit to have been in a bookie's shop.
Yeah. Sandy.
Yes.
He was from Wick or Thurso. He was from Wick or Thurso.
Uh-huh. I didn't
Wick.
Know.
Oh, there's people correcting us.
I didn't know the gentleman at all. Anyway, above that, at number 11, if we can go on to that for a minute, Malcolm.
Yes.
There's a very interesting family at number 11, at least the proprietor. But amongst the tenants, there was Alexander Kravitch, a jeweller whom we mentioned before. Obviously, he was of Polish or Russian origins. There was, at a later date, a chip shop. Malcolm, have you got something on Kravitch?
I've got something about him. He was called Big Sandy or Sandy Moore, and he died on the 18th of October, 1948, in Glasgow, age 65. And he was then a travelling jeweller. A travelling jeweller.
Oh, was he?
Yeah. Wow. How do you travel and sell
and
jewellery?
And do we know where he came from?
Well, his wife had died, and she, her name was Mary Steinmeier or something like that. This is from his death certificate. His father was a farmer called Hirsch Kravitch, and the mother was Rachel Bernstein. So it was obviously perhaps a Jewish connection.
Uh-huh. Well, that's probably why he
But he was quite well known in Stornoway. As, you know, when he was called Sandy Moore, he must have been quite well known in the rural areas, like Newton. Was Newton a rural area?
Anyway, I want to carry on, Malcolm. You just keep me going. We now move into the number 11 again, where Kravitch was. Before that, there was a tenant called Mrs. John Williamson. I don't know what she had. Was that the solicitors?
No,
completely different.
They were Lanarkshire people.
Uh-huh.
And funnily enough, there was also, where is it again? There was another gentleman who we'll come across later on from Lanarkshire, a MacDougall fellow, who was there before the First World War, until the 20s. And he was from Lanarkshire as well, so they might have come up together.
And I was going to make the point that in my early record here, at number 11, the proprietor, as distinct from the tenant, were the McFarker girls. There was Miss Annie and Alexandra McFarker. Now, well-known Stornoway family of that time, perhaps best known because of the Behead branch, the McFarkers, where the grain store was, and of course, the late Isabel Macdonald, the pharmacist Isabel Throckan, was her mother was Jenny McFarker. Mm-hmm. So they're a well-known family, but interestingly, amongst that family, there was a lady called Mrs. Annie Abbott. Now, I remember Mrs. Annie Abbott quite well. She stayed down in England, and she came visiting up here every now and again. And she wrote a rather interesting little booklet. Can you recall the name of it, Malcolm?
I cannot, Sandy, yeah.
PL, was that Sheaves from Fortrose? It was the same family.
Could have been.
Uh-huh. Sheaves from Fortrose and the other one about pearls.
Oh, no, that's...
Yes, and that family originally stayed roughly where your own shop was on Kenneth Street.
Oh yes.
In that house there. In fact, I think they built that house. And again, another name that we knew, although we didn't know this chap in that group of shops, was Domenico Cabrelli, fish merchant. Now he was one of the three brothers, wasn't
he? Yeah.
Luigi, Domenico, and.
You put me on the spot, Sandy.
What was the other one's name? Oh, come on.
I know. They're all failed the test like myself.
They're all having senior moments. So, anyway, there were the three Cabrelli brothers who came here, and, of course, the family continued down to our own day through Andrew Cabrelli.
And Andreas.
Andreas, well done. Andrew Cabrelli.
The penny drop.
And his cousin, the famous and much-loved Mary Cabrelli or Scaramuccia. So that was the Cabrelli person. Then, as I said before, there was John Bain. And also I see here you've got down Nasser Ahmed as one of the owners and occupiers of that number 11. We're moving on
to... It became 9 and 11 later on.
What?
Nasser Brothers, they had 9 and 11.
Yes.
And then across the street they had the 12 to 14, but we'll come to that again.
Well, that whole area, that whole cool, had a plethora of different shops and different proprietors and different
They were all
owners.
Small and some
They were all very small. And I suppose it goes back to the old days when, as I said once before, when someone was setting up a business, they often had the shop on the ground floor and they lived above it, which was economic and it was sensible. Hence the phrase which we all know, living above the shop. So that was happening. And these houses there were part, as I said at the beginning, that whole block was built by the MacLeod family. The Smarts, as we knew them, a famous family from Stornoway. Smart was just a nickname, not a proper name. And we know the descendants of the Smart family include John Cloody MacLeod and late Donald M. and Elizabeth MacPhail. That was a very distinguished family in the town 110 years ago. And Peter Smart was a town councillor, and his brother was the first one of the magistrates of Stornoway at the turn of the century.
Yeah.
Was he...
Roderick, wasn't it?
Who?
There was one of them called Roderick.
No, he wasn't Roderick, no.
Well, that was his brother. Roderick died here. Murdo MacLeod.
Murdo MacLeod, correct, who was also the bank agent and was responsible for setting up the first branch of the British Linen in Stornoway. So that whole area started off with one family, and over the years, bits and pieces of it were sold. Now, if we carry on with number 13, we come to...
The Symes.
The Symes shop. Now, I know that there's a descendant, a grandson of Syme here, a name that we all remember... Well, sorry, a name that many of us remember particularly well, and perhaps more than anything, we remember him for his clock. It was one of the few shops in town with a public clock fixed on the outside wall. And there was a great thing in Stornoway, and I'm not sure if I get the right accent, because Malcolm said, will we say it in English or will we say it in Stornoway? What's the time on Syme's clock? And I remember the clock myself very, very well.
And on Lana Drove, we would say, what's the time on Syme's clock?
Yes. So it was a bit of a Stornoway institution. It was a toy shop and a sweetie shop and lots of other things. And I took the trouble to look out an obituary to the Syme man that we knew, Tommy Syme. His father had come here from England in the 19th century, and the chap that we're going to be talking about with the clock was Thomas Henry Syme, who lived at that time, as the family did for many years after that, at 78 Keith Street. And the tribute here says, Syme's shop, 13 Church Street, has been a landmark in Stornoway for 60 years or more. And to the older generation, the foot of Church Street will always be known as Syme's Brae. The first representative of the family to settle in Stornoway was Robert Syme, who came to Lewes as a sergeant major with the Volunteers. The Volunteers, of course, being what we would call the Territorial Army or the Terriers. Sergeant Major, when his army service was over and that had been up at the drill hall, he opened a shop which soon became a well-known feature of the town. His son, Thomas Henry, that's the man I remember, followed the family tradition and entered the regular army when he was in his teens. After some years of service, he returned to Stornoway to assist his father in the family business. He was in the army again during the First World War. Now, Malcolm, the First World War is one of your specialties. He was he Brigade Trumpeter, Syme?
He was, yes.
Uh-huh. And he fought throughout the First World War at Salonika, which, as you know, is in the eastern part of Europe, just above Greece, where the Ross Mountain Battery, our own local battery, served with such distinction. He also served as a special constable during the Second World War. And I know that somewhere in the Historical Society's archives, there's a picture of all these gentlemen who served as special constables. And part of her duties, of course, was like that of a near raid warden. And they went around having you up if there was a chink of light coming out of your window or anything of that. So that was the same gentleman. But there's a little interesting note here. In the days before the multiple stores reached Lewes, Syme's shop offered a variety of sweets, toys and novelties to delight the heart of any youngster. Syme's stall at the market was one of the wonders of Lewes. Now, that market would have been in what we now know as Percival Square, roughly where the gateway into Percival Square is now, between the information office and the empty hydroelectric, or, you know, where the road goes in. That was where the Stornoway's market was at that time. Syme's stall at the market was one of the wonders of Lewes. The blasé child of the day who takes Woolworth for granted might be puzzled to know why his father was thrilled by a few toys and tarpaulin. Now, I remember my first hoopla set. Anyone know what a hoopla set was? You had a round rubber ring and you threw it and it caught onto a hook with various different numbers of values. And he had one in his window in his shop. And I took a notion to buy it. And of course, in those days, you couldn't buy anything you wanted anytime you wanted. You had to be somewhat subtle and pleading about those things. And just to move for a minute up Church Street. My mother had rebuffed my effort to buy Symes hoopla. But by the time I reached up to Louis Street, there was another toy shop which will come to Duggan's shop.
I'm
sure some of you remember Duggan. And in his shop, which later became the Prudential offices, but anyway, in Duggan's window, there was also a hoopla set. And I remember standing there, looking at it with great enthusiasm. And, you know, the man Duggan came and looked out at me at the window and shook his fist. So I said, well, when I buy my hoopla set, I'm not buying it here. And in due course, I was able to persuade my mother to take me back to Tommy Symes to get the hoopla set. So little things that we remember. A quick word about Mr. Syme himself. The article says, Tom Syme was a friendly and kindly soul with a quiet dignity of manner. His father had been an elder in St. Columba's Church, and there too he followed the tradition, being a loyal member of the congregation throughout his life and for a short time an office bearer of that church. He took an interest in public affairs in the town, was for many years a member of the old parish council. When they talk about parish council, that goes back quite a while. A member of the Borough Nursing Association, grandmaster of a loyal lodge of Oddfellows. His recreation was bowling, and until ill health forced him to give up, he enjoyed nothing so much as the camaraderie of the bowling green after his day at the counter. Now, that was 1951, and therefore many people here will have some memory of Mr. Syme's shop. After Mr. Syme died, the shop went into whose hands, Malcolm? Can you remind me?
It was taken over by Mrs. Henrietta MacLeod Sevenholm of the MacLeod and MacLeod family.
Yes, but that was not to be confused with a proper shop they had further up.
Oh, no, which
was
further up, yeah.
We'll come to that in a minute. But that was Tommy Syme at 13. Again, the properties there changed, but I think we can now move on.
Can I also mention that some of the properties on Church Street were actually stores for some of the shops, because they were such small shops. Well, Angus there,
himself,
his father had one.
Recounts in his lovely
and
book.
And those little, I was going to say Ginnells, that's very your choice, little closes. Yeah.
And to get to some of those shops, you had to come through Lipton's Close, as I knew it, but it had another name. Was it Murray's Close or... it was one of
Murray's was on Cromer Street, yeah.
But it went up. It was... I don't know whose close it was, but it was a close there. And you still went in that close to get to the various shops and sheds behind the frontage on Church Street. Malcolm, can we move on?
Yeah, number 17, MacLeod and MacLeod.
MacLeod and MacLeod. MacLeod and MacLeod, still going strong. Butchers, they had a lovely, very modern butcher shop, as I recall it. Beautiful white tiles and quite a classy shop. I'm sure you all remember that quite well. Willie MacLeod, two brothers from Sevenholm.
William and Kenneth.
Uh-huh. And, of course, the shop is still in the family in fourth generation now.
And the names are much the same.
Uh-huh. And they're famous, like Charlie Barley's, for black puddings, MacLeod's black puddings. So that's 13 and 17. Of course, there was a while, and maybe again you remember it, when Norman Mackenzie, the painter, had a paint shop and a wallpaper shop in that part of Church Street.
Symes.
Mm-hmm. Aha. On to 19 now. Again, the McFarkers and the Abbots owned some of the property here.
Can we go back? It's called the Colour Advice Centre now.
So?
Colour Advice Centre.
Is that what it is
That's
now?
What it
That's
is
what
now.
Janet was saying, Colour Advice Centre. Is it still open?
It is, yes.
Uh-huh. I never come up Church Street. I only go down it. It's somewhat easier. But that's right. You get confused. Now, we haven't even gone on to the other side, which is just as confusing. Anyway, we must hurry up, Malcolm, because...
But number 19.
Number 19. Well, again...
Which was the Highland News Offices way back. It was the Highland News Offices way back.
Yes. Again, yes, the Highland News. That was Miss MacLeod's office in the Highland News. And, of course, you know the importance of the Highland News was that it was Stornoway's paper right up until 1917. Now, of course, it covered the whole of the whole of the Highlands. Mm-hmm. But coming from Inverness, there was a local agent here. First of all, there was a lady called Miss MacLeod. Mm-hmm. And then there was James Shaw Grant's father, who was the local reporter for the Highland
William
News.
Grant.
William Grant. And in due course in 1917, William Grant created his own paper, the Stornoway Gazette of Happy Memory. No, it's not of Happy Memory.
Delete.
I shouldn't have said that. So we now go on to 19, and again there's interesting owners and tenants here. Mm-hmm. I noticed that in 1936, at 19, there was Alexander Bruce Coal Merchant. That would be Alexander Bruce Sr., Sandy's grandfather.
Not Thompson. Although he was Alexander Thompson Bruce.
He also, George McCormack's hairdressers. Now, I don't know which doorway was McCormack's hairdresser. Was that on the corner?
It was on the corner, yes. The famous photo, looking down on the left.
Right on the corner. It's now blocked off, but there was a door right on the corner.
Now, Becky Bruce had been
there
before.
Becky, Alexander's daughter, had that. But again, in my day, some of you may remember, but the barber shop after McCormack, there was a little gentleman called Johnny Thompson.
Yes, he's on your list there.
Johnny Thompson, hairdresser. But I remember, I'm sure many of you here will remember Johnny Thompson. We would go in there, and you went in the door and down steps into his shop.
I forgot.
And he came. Well, he was one of the famous Thompson brothers who were involved in different parts of the town. And Johnny died when he was quite young.
Yes.
He was living on MacLeod Road. Mm-hmm. And of course, he had a daughter, and he had two brothers, Billy, our own neighbour down in Seaview Terrace.
Billy and Bobby.
Was the same Thompsons, as was a classmate of my own. She's now Mrs. Mackenzie, Mary Thompson from Perth. That was all the same family. Anyway, Johnny was there, and it was a wonderful shop, like all barbers. It was a hive of gossip and talk, and if you wanted to go in there, you had to sit down and wait. And I often went into that shop for my haircut, and just sat until you were called. And of course, the great indignity for little boys was that he had a plank, and he put it on the arms of the chair. And you had to sit up on that so that he could reach you without having to bend too far down. And oh, I was pretty chuffed the day he allowed me to sit in the chair without the plank. So that was Johnny Thompson.
Did you get long trousers after that?
Was he a footballer?
There was a John Thompson played in the 30s, but I'm not sure if it's the same one.
I think it was.
The John Thompson played football was a wee winger, so could very well have been him. Now, one interesting thing about John Thompson was his two pre-war assistants were both killed in the Second World War.
Were they?
Well, one of them was, remember, Pat the Barber was Johnny Geeper, but we have said it. John the Barber. Remember Pat the Barber? His twin brother was one that was killed.
Oh, was he?
I just can't remember the other enough.
Pat the Barber, Pat Morrison from New Valley.
Benside,
thank you.
Joke his brother.
Anyway, we're still going on Church Street. We're moving on to 23 Malcolm. That's where Arras shop was in my day, although, again, it's now, this is the Blythewood shop.
It is the Blythewood shop.
And again, it's got a shop, the door is on the very corner of what used to be called Giant E. MacLeod's. Yeah. Of course, it was John and Elizabeth MacLeod.
Have you looked in the window lately?
No.
If you look at it, you'll still see in the stained-coloured glass Jai and E.
Oh, yes, of course, above the window, and that's right. Well, quite right. Well spotted, Malcolm. Now, that was a famous shop.
I only noticed once I got glasses.
I didn't. I'd forgotten about that, but you're quite right. Mm. If you look, you'll see them along the top of the...
Yeah, there's a little shield.
Uh-huh. Now, in my day, the shop was managed or run by the famous Ara. Ara Macaulay from Coolagrain, and she, again, a famous family. There was
the shop was called Ara's.
Absolutely, it was called Ara's shop, quite improperly because it was really John and Johnny Clooney
and Elizabeth
and Elizabeth's mother, a granny, who worked. I remember the granny very well. Old Johnny Clooney and Dr. MacPhail's wife's mother. She was a lovely lady. She was given to passing over a wing and a half meek to the wee boys when you would come in. She would give you some money. She was a generous old lady. I'm sure it was
probably, you got more than I got.
It was probably more than a wing and a half, a wing and a meek. It was probably a tanner you got from her. Anyway, she was a lovely lady.
I remember Joey Reid took over after that.
That's right, Joey Reid.
And they had a glass that they hid behind glass, but they could see the staff.
Yes, uh-huh. Mm-hmm. And, of course, at the back of the shop was the bakery. Mm-hmm. And there used to be a big green iron gate that you turned in and you went up. It's now flats.
Yeah, flats, that's right.
And Mr. MacLeod, Johnny Clooney himself, ran the bakery. Took me a wee while to understand that by virtue of being a baker, he had an early start every morning. And by the time I would see him when I was taken into the bake shop at 4 o'clock, he was just finishing off for the day because he had been probably at it since 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning making bread and so forth. And I remember the first time I saw pies being made with you put the dough on a thing like that, and he had a big machine and down it came and you got the pies that you get in the chip shop, not the big pies.
Mince pies.
And it was great fun to go round a baker's shop then. Of course, we've got to realise that nowadays, health and safety, if you put your... go into a baker's shop or any other kind of place like that, you could put on a helmet and a high-vis jacket and a mask and everything. So, again, it's well worth pointing out that our generation in town got into places that other people never got into, especially modern days. People just did not get to see how things worked. I remember one of the features of my life was being sent down to Arras first thing in the morning, especially if you had people staying at home. You were roused out of your bed at 7:30 and sent down to Arras to buy a dozen rolls and sometimes a plain loaf. Now, I mention a plain loaf because on more than one occasion, by the time the plain loaf had its way up to Gotill Road, it was full of mouse holes because you would go in and... lovely warm bread. If I'd thought properly about it, I'd have taken the butter down with me. But that was Chinese. And
now, just think how slim you'd have been if you had desisted.
It was all that bread that did it. But that reminds me of something completely unrelated to that shop, which was the height of style. Was another shop in town. Like so many shops, they sold a bit of everything. And there was this lady who had a small shop. I'm not going to mention her name in case her family will remember. And she sold, one of her specialties was the Crackan's biscuits. I suppose some of you will remember the Crackan from out in Laxdale, and he was famous for a big, thick biscuit. And you would
butter, butter melted onto it. Made it
and
really...
I think they cost a penny each, and you would go in to this lady's shop. She had a bit of groceries and barrels of this, that, and the next thing. And when you would order a penny biscuit, she would say, no butter. And I didn't quite know what she meant, but I've copied her and said, butter. And she went to a big barrel beside the counter. And spread the butter and added a half penny onto the price. Now, can you imagine getting away with that nowadays? Anyway, that's Cludie's shop. We go up one to the back of that. Mr. MacLeod also built a garage
on
that site, which came straight out onto the street.
Yeah.
But that was just below the shop. Not the shop, the yard.
Yeah.
Hoods.
Hoods, yeah.
I don't know if you remember Hood, the grave...
Alexander Hood.
Alexander Hood, who came from Wick.
Yeah, Wick, yeah.
And he did many of the tombstones for the town, and he had a wooden derrick in the garden,
right,
which I remember quite well.
He was called a monumental sculptor.
Monumental sculptor, yes.
And it was a white derrick.
Yes. What's there now?
The
wee Chinese...
The Thai.
Is that, that's where the Thai restaurant
is. Well, you got the Thai. And where Kenneth McLennan's bakery, you got the Bombay Bistro, Istanbul Takeaway, Bangla Spice Restaurant Takeaway. And, yeah, that's all in that area. So Church Street has moved up the way in terms of Indians and what have you. So.
Because at that point...
Do you remember when Church Street was referred to as Muhammad Ali?
I remember what?
Church Street was named Muhammad Ali.
No.
That was because of all the Indian shows.
But that particular shop... After it, again, you may just remember, before it was built over by the thing, Macdonald had a plumber's business there, you know, Swanee from back or
and
tongue.
He's moved into monumental things, and he had stones there. He's now, of course, on the other side of Church Street.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I think it's time we came back down the Bray, and we'll start at the bottom of Church Street again and come up as far as...
The only thing that was further up was, remember, Motor McDonald's, Motor Carpets had a warehouse. But that's all on that side, so we go to the other side now.
No, we better go up as far as Keith Street, Malcolm, because on the corner of Keith Street, where the Indian restaurant is now... It was an empty site, as I remember it, as a child. And then Roddy McLean, the baker.
Yes, I did touch on it briefly. But
build,
Roddy McLean, first
build
of all, yes.
A bakery
then
right
McLean.
On the corner. His shop being round the corner in Keith Street. But Roddy, we called him Roddy Doogie. And, of course, there was his brother, Doogie. who had the butcher shop
on
the corner. We'll come to that. But that building, ultimately, it became the bakery for Kenneth McLennan, Kenny Buller from Tongue, and it has now been converted into the Indian...
I gave the list. I can't do it again.
The Indian restaurant.
Yeah,
I'm just using these.
Bangla Spice, etc.
The Indian restaurant as an area, a label for people to identify with what's there.
That's right.
Now, anyway, we'll Have I got your permission to go back down Church Street?
Yeah, that's the only way you go.
Yes, the only way I walk. So we're going to go down to the bottom of Church Street again, junction with Cromwell Street, and we're going to come up on the left-hand side as far as time will permit us. Yeah. When do we have to finish, Malcolm? Next Friday. Anyway, we'll go down to the bottom.
But the last time, they didn't check us out as quickly as the previous time, so we're okay.
We're okay. We're going down to what was called number 2 Church Street. And I see here that in our day, the owner in 1951 and 58 and 63 was Mrs. Catherine Macaulay. Now, that's Mrs. Macaulay of Chippy's family.
Yeah, the Francis Street.
Who lived round on Keith Street, where young Chippy stays now. Mm-hmm. That's an interesting family in itself because of its Uig connections. But she was the owner of the property. And I see here that at number 2, there was Angus Mackenzie Draper.
Yeah.
Now, I have a vague memory of a very small shop in there, and it was pretty run down, and it had clothes. I didn't know the word draper then. That was Angus Mackenzie. Anyone know who that Angus Mackenzie was? And then after that Angus, there was someone called Mrs. Kay McLennan.
Spirella.
Who was that?
Spirella. Do you know any about
Corsets? Would you mind telling me what is a Spirella? nice and tight. Thank you, that's very good. She came from Newmarket, I think. Uh-huh. Anyway, that was Spirella. And she... Ultimately, that number 2 was bought over by John McKeever, the Peel, as a fish shop. But going back to my own time, Malcolm, above the Spirella shop, there was a shop that was empty, a property that was empty most of the time. And that was the surgery for Chris Munro, the vet. Now, Chris was my own neighbour in Gutil across the road. And, you know, it wasn't until years and years later that I realised that was his surgery. Mm-hmm. Because Chris practised his profession mostly from his house, both houses on Gutil Road, and from various other convenient places round the town. I leave the matter hanging there. Sometimes, indeed, I think it included the golf club. Anyway, that was Chris. He was a lovely man, but he didn't go into surgery all that often.
So you could add at number 2. My mother worked at number 2 for a little while.
Did she?
Because A.H. Colquhoun Monumental Masons were there in the 60s.
Uh-huh.
And that's where my first job was there.
Was it?
I was a tombstone salesman for 2 weeks.
So after...
I was on commission, so I didn't earn very much.
we now come to number 6. And I see here there's a Donald Chisholm, a baker. Now, that was a long time before my memory. And
yeah, he had gone by the Second World War.
I think that Donald Chisholm baker, was he the father of Donnie Chisholm, who lived on Kennedy Terrace?
Grandfather.
Can anyone help me with that?
Grandfather, they say. Grandfather.
A grandfather. I mean Donnie the weaver.
Yeah.
Okay. So that was Chisholm. Yeah. Interestingly, as well as the tenant there, George Watson, optician. He was he not the man, I've mentioned this before, who lodged out somewhere around your own place on Roper Road or Westview Terrace?
I think so. He certainly had his shop on Keith Street for later on.
No, he was on
the
Church Street where the chip shop.
Oh, yeah, but did
and
you
he
not?
Went to,
Oh, yeah, that's what I meant. Number 77 or something. Yeah.
On the corner?
Yeah.
Well, what, roughly what Boots' house is now.
Well, it's just down from that. The Flora
MacLeod was just one down from that, but that's another story. My own story about Mr. Watson is, as I say, he lived on Westview Terrace. And in those days, Stag Road, very poor and inadequate housing. And the people there had a lack of facilities. And it was very much like the High Street in Edinburgh, where, to quote the historians, the residents threw the night soil out the window and shouted, as we heard, "Gare de l'eau." Now, that phrase wasn't known on Stag Road. And one morning, Mr. Watson was making his way to work. It must have been a dark morning.
Very showery.
Well, all of a sudden, he found himself drenched with the contents of a chamber pot which had been thrown out the window. Shortly after that, the man moved his lodgings to a more salubrious part of town. So that was George Watson, if any of you remember him. Who do we come to after that, Malcolm? I'm getting confused.
We were doing number six.
Then it became the chip shop.
Yeah, it became the chip shop. And it still is a chip shop.
Still a chip, and they're of course different. Yeah. But the chip shop that we knew on Church Street, it was the Macaulay girls who moved from the wee cool on Francis Street in the yard the junction of Keith Street and Church Street, where the Telephone Exchange car park is now.
Yes.
You used to go up there. But after a while, they moved into this shop here on Church Street.
Do you remember
Street.
That shop had a lighthouse in the
window? Oh, yes. The National Federation of Fitzfriars.
Yeah.
It was a lighthouse and it was apparently a seal of approval for buying your fish and chips.
There was a story of there was a big queue one night, and there were sailors in, you know, and they were waiting and waiting and waiting. And about 25 minutes had passed, and one of the sailors pointed at the, because there was a sign underneath it for ships that pass in the night. And he says, "I think it's for chips that pass in the night." And a few locals heard it.
And then if we move on to past the chip shop, there was another little shop in the back. There was a close shop, wasn't in the back, but it was on the street. But there was a close with a green gate. I'm sure you'll remember it, Angus. And in the butcher shop beside there, there was a butcher shop run by a gentleman called John Morrison. He came from Uig.
Brainish, wasn't it?
What?
Brainish.
Brainish?
Yes.
Well, yeah, you see.
Oh, I'm very brainish.
I remember him very well because he was a big, tall man with a round head and very, very rosy cheeks, if I remember correctly. And for some peculiar reason, I, in my childhood, imagined that he was actually a doppelganger for the giant in Jack the Giant Killer. And I always looked at that poor man in the strangest sort of way. But my other memory for remembering that show was the fact that a kinsman of my own, John Matheson, a brother of Doya, worked in that shop for a while. And then after Mr. Morrison went, I don't know what happened to the shop.
Nasser.
Yeah, it'd be Nasser.
Oh, it says here,
Habib Allah. And then it became Nasser Brothers, 8 to 10, as we mentioned earlier on.
And then we go up one
can I mention John Morrison? His brother was lost in the Isle. And John Morrison, at the age of 14, had to take the cart over to collect his brother's body.
Aye.
And it took him 3 days.
That's very interesting to know that. I don't know who Mrs. Morrison was at all, but they lived above the shop.
Yes.
Thanks, Angus, they lived above the shop. But we're now moving up one more, and we come next to a sweetie shop. I'm sure you all remember Tarmat the Vicks, Norman MacLeod, who had a lovely little sweetie shop, which was distinguished, to my mind, by the wooden panelling inside the shop. There was a seat right opposite the counter where the boys could go in. This was in the days before the cobbler's shop. The boys would go in and sit down and chat. But the memorable thing about that shop was it was run by... It was occupied fairly frequently by the two sons, Donnie B. MacLeod of television fame and his brother John Norrie. And unfortunately, these guys plastered the walls of the shop with pictures.
Of Rangers?
Of Rangers. And yeah, I got the impression, unless you were a signed-up Ranger supporter, you wouldn't get served in that shop. So it was, again, one of the places where kids would want to go. And, of course, old Norman stayed round on Kenneth Street. And others of you will know that Norman had a daughter, Annette, who passed away just a few months ago, and another daughter, Mrs. Stewart, I think, who lived in Inverness. So that was a famous family, famous shop. And then on the corner, which is now, is it the Blythewood Tract Society?
It was the Blythewood.
It was
the It's now Swanies.
It's now...
Swanies.
Yes, but it was it was a religious bookshop on the corner
while. For a long time.
I don't know what's in it now.
Swanies.
Swanee, yes. Well, you're not listening. Your teacher told me about you.
And that shop had previously been a hairdresser's shop, hadn't it, Malcolm?
Yes, yeah.
I remember Flora MacLeod in there.
Yes, Flora MacLeod.
And I think Becky Bruce might have been in there.
Yeah, it was Willie Bruce was there and Becky Bruce. Yeah.
For those of you who don't know, Becky Bruce, Becky Prince, George Prince's wife afterwards. And here are we, Malcolm.
Yeah, well, it was, we mentioned all these. That was Bruce's, and then Flora MacLeod bought it in 1958. So we're moving on to 18. Number 18.
Number 18.
It's over the page. We're moving on fast.
There's no need to shout at me. I'm not deaf. Number 18. No, but we haven't finished number 12.
Well, we can go back to 12.
I don't know who was there. Okay, we'll go over Malcolm's
time. Oh, you found it, yes.
Go to over 18. Yeah. Yes. And we come to an interesting name here. That was across Kenneth Street in the little buildings behind what was DJ the Dentist's. Mm-hmm. The house on the corner where the police station is now, where the bins are stored if you're going along Kenneth Street. Now, that in my day was where DJ the Dentist and his sidekick, Johnny Matheson, yep. Owlack, had their shop. And just for a moment, do you all remember DJ? He was another professional who worked at, how can I put it, irregular hours. What's it called? Flexi time. And DJ was my dentist, and for a reason which it took me a long, long time to work out, he always gave me an evening appointment at 7:30 or 8 o'clock at night. And it was only one evening when something went wrong that I realised that dear old DJ had his evening meal across the road in the Royal Hotel. He was a lovely man. He was a very good dentist, but he didn't go in for modern equipment. I distinctly remember his drill. It was worked by peddling a machine beside him. And, you know, you would sit there. And he was quite a great man because he was a Lieutenant Colonel D.J. Macdonald. He came from Carraway. Some of you will remember his children, the late Rani Macdonald. and the daughter, Mary Agnes, who is still alive out in Vancouver, I think. Anyway, DJ was a great fellow, and he always used to tell me stories about his time in Gallipoli and in the Ross Mountain Battery, and that was always a good way to while the terrible hours. And again, you'll perhaps remember in his downstairs waiting room, he had a ship's microphone, we call it a microphone now.
A voice pipe.
A pipe, yes. And you'd be sitting there in his shop, and you would hear this voice coming from the wall saying, Mr. Matheson? It's what do you call it?
A voice pipe.
A voice pipe.
It was like he would speak up, down to the engineers.
He was upstairs coming round to you. That was DJ. Now, that house had a whole host of outhouses all the way up to the back of a police station. We'll come to that in a minute, where beside what in our day was Elizabeth Arts Kingdom Hall and all the rest of it. We'll discuss that in a minute. But in all those little house sheds coming on to Church Street, there was the bicycle shop.
Yeah.
A gentleman from Point called Darkey had a bicycle shop, but it was owned by Jimmy Clean, for those of you who remember Jimmy Clean. And beside that, there was the Transport and General Workers Union office.
Yeah.
And then you went up again, and there was the under... Yes, he was Mr. M.J. MacArthur, joiner and undertaker. And he had a sign that went stuck out into the street with it. And again, it took me quite a while to realise that Colum MacArthur, what an undertaker was, until I think one day that I was told that he would bury me if I wasn't careful. So he was an undertaker. And he had his shop there. I'm sure you all know that Colum MacArthur came from Achmore and ultimately lived on James Street, 24.
And his twin brother was a good singer. His twin brother was a good singer.
Was he?
Yes.
No, that was the boys.
Oh, the boys. Oh,
the
sorry.
Boys. Yeah. One of the sons was a mod good medalist. Yeah. And there was a present gentleman living in his own house on James Street, and of course there was a girl who was married to Reverend John MacLeod, the Free Presbyterian minister, but we're moving away from the subject just now. Colum MacArthur was in there, and ultimately that whole area, above Colum MacArthur, some of you may remember in the wall of that yard at the back of the dentist's surgery, there were windows with wooden shutters. Anyone remember? Well, they weren't windows with wooden shutters. They were portholes for fish when the herring was in season. The carts would go down and fill up with herring or whatever fish, and they would go up there and the shutter would be taken down, and the fish were put in through the window into the curing yard, because at the back of that place was Kenny Sticky's fish curing yard.
Yeah, yeah.
It was never used as that in our time.
No.
But again, it's an example of the man had the front house where the dentist was, and his back garden, if you want, was used as a fish curer's yard. And you had to go in a gate beside Marvin's shop, which was gable end onto the road. In our day, there was Stjallak's blacksmith shop, which was the second shop that Stjallak had there. But in the backyard were all little sheds and different places.
Little salt stores and things like that.
Uh-huh. And I was taking a bit of a liberty there.
Even Ben and Morrison had a little store around there. He's nodding.
I was taking.
We noticed that you weren't paying very much on the rates.
No, I was taking a bit of a liberty there when I said Kenny Stickey. I should actually have said Provost Mackenzie, not the Provost Mackenzie Alistair, but the original Provost Kenneth Mackenzie, who was the founder of a fish curing business. And of course, later on, he became involved in the Harris Tweed business and the building on Louis Street, first of all, and then on Sandwick Road, Kenneth Mackenzie Limited. Now, I am led to believe, and maybe one of you other people can confirm this, he was called Kenny Stickey. Now, it had nothing to do with being sticky or anything like that. I understand, and I don't know the Gaelic for it, Kenny Stickey is sticky, the Gaelic word for a stick or anything like that, or a bit of wood, I don't know. But he got the name Stickey because he had, like all fish curers, he had a wooden thing, like a policeman's baton, but much smaller. And it was weighted with a bit of lead on or something. And those of you who remember your science will perhaps remember a thing called a hygrometer.
Oh. The whirling hygrometer.
No.
No, not the whirling.
Not one. A hydrometer.
Hygrometer.
A hygrometer.
Yes, a whirling one.
A grommet. You know the.
Oh, I see.
The wee fellow, grommet. Anyway.
That's a chair. Any,
anyway, he kept it up his sleeve. And when he was going round checking the brine in the herring barrels, because, you know, they had brine for curing the herring, he would take the stick out, let it slide down his hand, and it would sit in the barrel. And if the salt was at the correct salinity or level, the stick would sit upright to a mark. So it was an early form of quality control for brine for herring.
I used one in the mill for checking the density of the soap and the the washing soda.
And did they ever call you Malcolm Sticky? Anyway,
you might have coined a phrase.
that in the back of that yard, all that area, as you know, was in when 1971 or 72, it was cleared to become the current police station.
1969, it was on Facebook this week.
Yes, it was 1969, it was officially opened.
Opened.
And I remember, I felt on Facebook, I felt like writing to them and saying, I was there too, because there had been photographs of it, and I wasn't in any of them. But I remember being there, and if you promise not to repeat the story, at the end of the opening ceremony, we repaired, is the word I think, to the premises of Mr. Alistair Matheson in the Crown Hotel. And I don't remember the following day at all. But that's by the way. That was the opening of the police station. Now, just above the police, where the cells are now, there was the gable end building where Mr. Marvin the plumber had his business. And up above that, again in my day, there was an empty space all the way up between that building and the back of Doogie's shop. That's the shop on the corner. And it was in there that Stjalak had his first smithy, because I remember as kids we used to go in there, and it was really a wooden shed, a corrugated iron shed, and you would go in there, and then they were moved from there.
Down the street.
And they moved round the corner, round the building, in order for Innes of Ard to build his offices and showrooms, and above it, what I remember was called Kingdom Hall.
Yes, yeah.
And that was one of the nice new buildings in Stornoway.
I need a showroom.
1951 or 52 that was
and
done.
Those flats up above. And the Kingdom Hall.
Who else was in that space, do you know? Does it say here?
Oh, well, I can tell you what's there just now. It's 30-32. It's Peking cuisine and East meets West, which is a shoe shop. Men only, the barbers, and then DC McMillan is a mobile phone repair.
Sure.
That's what's there.
That was running the yard.
Yeah. No, no, that's in the present day.
Oh, the shops, present day.
Yeah.
It's a barber.
You
there.
Haven't? Yeah, you don't go very often, do you?
Told you I never go down Church Street. I've forgotten that. And then, of course, above that yard, there was the back of Doogie's shop on the corner, which was actually a Keith Street address, Malcolm.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
But
there's another shop has gone up there. Remember, there was a pet shop there, and now it's complete osteopathy, where you get sports injuries and...
That was a much later addition.
Oh, it is, yes. It wasn't there at all. It
wasn't there when I was a little boy. And again, just for those of you who are interested in historical research, I see from the notes that Malcolm very kindly prepared, much of these properties were owned by Lawad, Lahwad.
But that was back in the 20s.
And Lawad was the name for Lewis and Harris Welfare and Development.
Yeah.
A company set up by Lord Leverhulme to purchase as many properties in town as he could so that he could demolish them and build his famous town with town halls and railway station and all the rest of it and lay out the beautiful avenues. Mm-hmm. And this company was called Lawad. Now, when Lord Leverhulme, this is part of the story of Lord Leverhulme, it's worth mentioning if I take a minute. Lord Leverhulme bought up the properties that he wanted through Lawad. And of course, many of the people who were in the existing properties struck a very hard bargain with Leverhulme, who wouldn't know a hard bargain unless he was making it. They got sold it to Leverhulme. Other people had properties that Leverhulme didn't want to buy. And you can imagine in a small town like Stornoway, the bitterness, jealousy, angry that caused. He bought your property, but he didn't buy mine. So that was all part of the anti-Leverhulme age. But when Leverhulme went, an interesting thing happened. Lawad was transferred to, I don't quite know what, but over the next few years after 1925, it was run down, although many properties were under that name, there's lots and lots of properties around the town. But funnily enough, some of the people who in 1921 had sold their property to Leverhulme's Lawad, when he went, they were able to buy it back at a song. So they had made a great deal on that. But Lawad, I mention that because to me it's one of the fundamental parts of our history.
Yeah. They even had a football team in the league for 1 year.
Uh-huh.
I can't imagine singing "We Love Lawad."
See, Lawad had lots of different properties throughout the town, especially down on Point Street, round where Johnny the Barber's shop used to be, on Shell Street and various other places. Lots of properties were still belong to Lawad, but were gifted, some to the Stornoway Trust, and many of them to the Stornoway Pier and Harbour Commission after Leverhulme went. So will you all remember Lawad? I should hope so. How are we doing for time?
Can we move on to the butcher's family? The Smith butcher's family.
The McLeans.
Our treasures. No, the Smiths.
Brackies.
Number 34.
Oh, of course, your treasurers.
You can't miss them out.
Where are they in Morecambe?
Number 34.
Oh, yes.
After Angus MacLeod.
That was where Angus MacLeod was. He was at 30 or 30. Okay.
The Smiths, they were out in... He was out in South America.
Because the Smiths, to me, were on the corner of Church Street and Keith Street, Bobby Brackey's.
Opposite
Doogie's shop. Yeah. And to some extent, we should just... Because we mentioned Kenny and Roddy Doogie. Kenny Doogie wasn't there at all.
That's another story. Kenny Doogie and Johnny Vrackey used to be shouting to each other across the street because one was an Aths man, the other was a United man. and Kenny would disappear if Aths lost and Johnny would be out cheering.
the Doogie's family came from Skye and quite a big family there of them. And they, as I said, they had the butchers and the bake shop there, and all that has changed hands now. Mm-hmm. Again, I've forgotten who's in it.
The Johnny Vrackey shop, I don't think there's anybody in it at the moment, but it was Grimm's wallpaper shop, also Wilma's hairstylist. I can't remember. There were others.
There was a period in the history of my own remembrance when
there was another hairstylist.
The Smiths had before they went down to Francis Street to Willie John's shop. They also had they owned the house on Keith Street, where the hairdressers is now. What's it called? That Peggy, where the hairdressers is now. They had upstairs where the Smith family, but on the ground floor, there was another wonderful little shop where they sold bread with mousetrap holes in it. And that was Kitty Ranger. Who remembers famous Kitty Ranger?
I'm glad to see you're supporting the Rangers at last.
A daughter of Sam Ranger, who built the house on Rose Street. And Katie was a lovely lady. And again, I used to patronise on my mother's instructions that particular shop. Do any of you remember the big advert she had of the Highlander, chief of somebody or other? Well, it covered practically a wall. I forget who it was, a Macpherson of Clooney or something, and it was on her shop. And funnily enough, given my own deafness, I never really understood what deafness was until I went in one morning to Katie Ranger's to buy something. And I said, I will have a loaf and 12 scones or something like that. And she looked at me and she said, I'm sorry, we've got no carrots in today. And that was the first time that I realised how you could get things wrong.
I know.
With deafness.
She had a sister, Baba Ranger, and a brother, Duncan Ranger.
Yes, Duncan died young.
Yeah,
he worked at the Stornoway Trust office.
That's right, He used to go around in a motorbike with a sidecar and collect the money and throw the money in from the laundry and places like that.
Now, of course, Sam Ranger was a famous painter. House decorator in Stornoway. I don't know where the Rangers came from. Glasgow?
I don't know. Glasgow. You mean down Governway?
down Governway, yes. They went bankrupt a few years ago.
That's it, yeah.
Aye. Malcolm, when are we finishing?
Well, we've only got two shops to go.
Two pages to go?
Two shops. We've got Ian McMillan, the dentist, and Paddy Reed's, which is also Duggan's.
Yes. Now,
can we do that?
42.
Yeah.
It's before we come to 42. There was the other house at 30. No, Christian House. A big set of flats. I don't know who owned that.
A lot of people.
A lot of people lived in it.
Yeah.
But many of these.
Yeah.
Who?
Malcolm MacLean.
Malcolm MacLean.
Yeah.
Did he own Christian House?
Yes.
At one time.
You mean Malcolm Skianow?
Yes, yeah.
I didn't know that. I certainly
you'd have gone there for another loaf.
I certainly remember some of the people who lived in Croydon House. I think there were four different flats in it. One of my teachers lived there, I think. Was it Torpedo's wife?
That's right.
Oh. There we are. Yeah. I remember that then.
So Willie Booker lived there.
Next to Croydon House, which is a lovely, big, well-built house, there was a small lean-to, number 42.
That's it.
Now, it was in that house that the Jones family stayed. Mm-hmm. Now, who were the Jones family? The Jones family...
Well, there's a Jones family. It's known I don't know if Margaret knows anything about it. No.
Keeping up with the Joneses. Mm-hmm. Mary Macmillan, the dentist's parents were living in there. And it was very interesting that 20 years after, or indeed more than 20, 30 years after they had gone away from there, it was occupied by Mary's husband, Ian Macmillan, the dentist, along with Ian Murdo Matheson from back. They were all in that little... But in another time...
And Kenny Macmillan was the dental mechanic.
He was a dental mechanic, that's right. Is that what he was?
Well, he was in a wee room by the side. I think he had different hours as well.
But he is. Flexi time, it's known as. And before that, another interesting character from Stornoway lived in there. No? Roddy M. MacLeod of Newell's Mill, of Churchill Drive, Shawbust, Tweed Designer, ATC, and all the rest of it. I'm sure you all remember Roddy M. He was a very handsome catch.
His wife was Margot.
Margot was his wife, yes. So Roddy M. and Mighty was in there. Mm-hmm. And then next door to that, there was Duggan's shop, the man who was knocking the window on me. And after Duggan went, it became the Prudential offices under D.W. Mackenzie.
Yeah, that's right.
And after that, the eponymous Paddy Reed.
That's right.
Had it as a tobacconist's and pipe shop.
Yeah. And once the hostel closed down, the income went...
St. Duth's House, that's what it's called.
Yeah. And it was MacLeod Insurances until very recently, and it's now reverted to becoming a private house.
Going back to becoming a private house.
Yes.
Again, a place where the shop was on the ground floor and the house was upstairs.
Now, Sandy, we're coming up towards 8:30, so we've now finished Francis Street. We haven't gone on to Francis Street, sir. I'm confused.
We haven't even made it to Francis Street yet.
You might be deaf, but I'm dumb.
No, we haven't touched on the rest of Church Street. But if you just very quickly, we come to St. Columba's Church, 1794, as I said. And next to St. Columba's Church, at the back of it, there was a building, again on Facebook recently, called The Cottage. And you, ladies and gentlemen, would remember The Cottage as Hostel. Elizabeth Haldane Hostel. The girls' hostel in my day, although slightly before my time, and people in the back of the room will remember it was the boys' hostel from 1930-something.
Early 30s, yes.
Uh-huh. And that place, The Cottage, had been built by Sir James Matheson, as I understand it, for what was called a dower house, D-O-W-E-R. And that, a dower house, was where the widow went to live after the husband had died and the succession had gone on to the oldest son. So in that place, The Cottage, which in my day was the girls' hostel, before then, a variety of different people stayed tenants in there. There was Dr. Murray, the first MP.
Yes.
There was Sheriff somebody.
Haldane.
Funnily
enough, he was called Haldane.
But that was just coincidence.
Yeah, but it was a coincidence with the Carnegie Hostel, because Elizabeth Carnegie, the last manager of the Imperial Hotel, was called Frank Pierre Carnegie.
That's right.
So, total coincidences.
Very coincidence. Now, again, you'll remember in the girls' hostel, it was under the matronship in my day of Miss Cowie.
Janet Cowie, who died very recently.
Janet Cowie, he passed away not long ago.
Now, can you describe the fire escape for us? Can you describe the fire escape for us?
And she was aided and abetted in the care and custody of the young ladies by Anne Wan Dean, Anne MacLeod from the Crescent. But of course...
And Miss Black.
I'm coming to that. I'm coming to that, Caney. They had a resident teacher as well, and that was Gertie, Miss Black, for me, very happy memory. Mm-hmm. And you will all know that Miss Black's companion was Mr. Kenneth Mackenzie, some of whom you will recall as Caney. I saw something on Facebook about it the other day, and Caney Mackenzie had nothing whatsoever to do with the cane. He was pretty fierce. He could handle a Loch Gelly with some considerable aplomb. You know, just. But he was called Caney. He came from Gearloch. He was born in 1896 in Oppinan House, Gearloch. He was called Caney because when in the accent and dialect of Loch Broom or Gearloch, they didn't say Kenny, they said Caney. It sounded like that, and that was why he was called Caney Mackenzie. I always feel quite annoyed when people put the strap on the man when it's got nothing to do with that at all. So that was Caney and Gertie. Quickly, we'll finish off on that side of the road. Next one, we come to Barvas Lodge. Barvas Lodge. Why is it called Barvas Lodge? Because it was built by Dr.
Charles McRae,
whose father had been for many, many years the minister in Barvas. William McRae, I think, was it, Malcolm?
I think so, yes.
And when his son made it good, because he was a very capable doctor, he built this house on the corner there, and naturally he called it Barvas Lodge. And of course we know that Barvas Lodge was ultimately bought by a number of people, Norrie McKeever and then Kirsty and Callum McKeever, Kirsty still lives. So that was why Barvas Lodge got its name. Quickly on the other side, the drill hall, still there, built about 1851, 52, after that, probably 1860 or 70.
After 1860, the volunteers were formed in 1860.
The Ross Mountain Battery.
They were the Stornoway volunteers to start with.
So that was the drill hall, still there. Some of you may remember, in my day, the man in charge of the drill house, living in the drill house, was Dan McCaskill.
Yeah.
He had...
the battery quartermaster sergeant. Yeah.
And he had a daughter, May McCaskill, who was living down in Holm, and he had a son, Ginger McCaskill, who lived on Seaview Terrace. So Dan McCaskill was a lovely little man who was in charge of the drill hall house. Then we move on to what is now the opticians under Robert Doig. And as you all know, that was built in 1876 as the manse for the Gaelic Free Church. No, the English Free Church. The Gaelic Free Church was on Kenneth Street. That's a history all on its own. And then, of course, it was, as I say, the Free Church, believe it or not, and Martin's Memorial was the Free Church English and the manse in my day.
Rosebank became a radio station as well, and social work as well had it. In 1975.
Yes, before the radio station.
Yes, yeah.
But
Radio Nanyilan, yeah.
I was just going to go back.
Can you sing Radio Nanyilan? You know, remember when you were the convener, there was a song about Radio Nanyilan and the council.
I was never the convener.
Oh, you were up there. You were in a higher position then.
Anyway, going back to Martin's Manse, as we all knew it, one of the most colourful characters and ministers in there was the good Dr. Delingen. I don't know if you'll remember Dr. Delingen, but I certainly do. He had a bicycle and he had a dog. And the dog was called Macpherson. And he was a charming old world gentleman. And he had a very, very interesting career. He was born in what was called St. Petersburg, Leningrad, and now St. Petersburg again. He was born there, where his father was in charge of the British Overseas Christian Mission. Anyway, John something something Delingen was born there. He came back home to Scotland and he went to university. And then he went, after war service and that, he went out to work in Mauritius, the Pacific Islands, where he worked as a teacher there in college. All very good. At the end of the war, he came back home, and in 1951, he was appointed to Stornoway. Mm-hmm. But the interesting thing for me was that Dr. Delingen, who was a very clever academic man, he has written a book which is now regarded as the seminal book in English on the Hindu faith. And he had a, I was quite surprised to find out, he had a very wonderful reputation as a scholar. I don't know if any of you people, one or two of you, must have gone to Martin's and heard him preaching, as I did every now and again. And and I wish you would tell this around the town. He finished every Sunday at 12 o'clock. Which, to my mind, was quite adequate, and he was very good.
Now, we've been at the manse, Rosebank and Church Street, and you're talking about a church in Francis Street. Is that not the right time to finish?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Time is pushing on, folks, and you know we'll be chucked out.
Is that it?
Short before nine. Unless there's anybody got a point of order question.
I think you better. Finish quickly before I tell my next story.
That's what I feared.
Well, I'll have to be very careful about this one. Not far from Martin's Manse, there was a family of great fame for two or three generations in Stornoway. And it's not for me to mention the family. They were connected with the Royal Bank, with an inspector of schools, and a doctor who had served with some distinction in the Royal Indian Medical Service, the Indian Medical Service, and had a distinguished career in the First World War. Anyway, after he had finished his service, he came home and he retired to the home, as I say, near the manse, within sight of the manse. And this gentleman, as well as having a son, he had a very comely and frisky, be quiet, frisky daughter, a risque daughter, a girl of some considerable charm. And one night...
The penny's dropping now, it's Sunday.
One night, Dr. Dillingen, Doctor of Theology, went over the way to visit his compatriot, the other doctor who had been in the Indian Medical Service, and they were having a ceilidh in the man's front room. And the daughter came into the room and sported herself around and in a sort of fashion that I dare say Dr. Dillingen would not have thought proper for a young lady. And ultimately, to try and ease the conversation, he turned to the lady and said, "My dear," he called her by her name, "my dear, you know, I'm so upset about you. You know, last night I prayed for you. I prayed so hard for you." And the girl just looked at him and said, "You silly old fool, why didn't you telephone?" So, there you are. Okay.
On that note, I'd like to thank you all for coming along. Thank you very much.